spasticity will be a symptom seen in people with multiple sclerosis, and it will be an increase in the stiffness of the limb. So when you try to move a joint, be it the ankle, knee, elbow, you might feel it stiffer than normal. Or if someone also with an assessment moves your limb, they'll feel it also stiff. And this stiffness gets worse the faster you move. Spasticity will affect individual muscles, and you can have spasticity which is regional, for example, affecting the foot or the ankle, or it could be generalized, affecting both legs and the trunk and the arms. But with spasticity, you'll find the symptoms when you try and move. You'll feel this stiffness. In contrast with a spasm, what you'll find is you'll get multiple muscles, for example, in the leg, contracting almost at the same time to produce some characteristic movements. These could be the leg bending up, it could be the leg going straight, it could be the leg crossing over as well. The leg bending up will be called a flexor spasm, the leg going straight will be called an extensor spasm. When the legs cross in, it's called an adductor spasm. What causes spasticity? Spasticity is caused by an increase in your stretch reflexes. So you might remember or have seen when someone taps, for example, your knee contracts automatically. And in people with spasticity, that stretch reflex is bigger than normal because the control of the stretch reflex from the central nervous system isn't dampened anymore, so it just becomes excessive. In someone with spasms, what you will find is that there is a increase in certain reflexes that we normally use in everyday life. So for example, if someone stood on a pin, your leg would immediately jump up, flex, and the other leg would go straight to keep you upright. And if those reflexes become excessive, then that will cause a spasm. In spasticity and spasm, there is an increase in activity within your spinal cord. Anything further increasing the activity in your spinal cord can make the spasm or the spasticity worse. So if you have sensory inputs, for example, from a pressure sore, or for example, from a full bladder or a urinary tract infection, that will send signals into the spinal cord and it will make the spasticity and spasm worse. And all of those are what we call trigger factors. A contracture is a decrease in the length of the muscle, in the muscle extensibility, and that means that the joint itself, for example, your knee, your ankle, your elbow, won't move as far. And the aim really will be to try and prevent that stage of getting a contracture. Clonus will be a repetitive contraction, which is caused by repetitive activation of the stretch reflexes, which are enhanced in people with spasticity. So it will only be seen in certain occasions. So commonly it's seen at the ankle, for example, when someone's sitting and the ball of the foot is on the ground, but the heel isn't. And the weight of gravity just tends to make the muscle at the back of the leg stretch, and it causes a little contraction. And then that eases off, and then gravity causes it to stretch again, causes it contraction, and it carries on and on and on. So often people minimize clonus by putting weight right through that knee to actually dampen it down.
So there are two main areas that spasticity can be treated. There is one area where we have some drugs, medications, but we don't have that many that can specifically target and manage spasticity. So we have to use them really carefully. And you will find that your clinician may start your dose very, very low and you think, oh, I want more than that. But work with your clinician, because they will want to have a low dose and they'll go slow and gradually increase it. And it's really important that you work with your clinician to find out the right dose for you. And also how you use those drugs over the day to help you function. So again, speaking to your physio, your nurse, your doctor, how the best way to manage that. So we have the drugs, but equally important are all the other things you do in your day-to-day with regard to your movement and your posture, how you position yourself in bed, how you move around. And again, your physio or your nurse or your doctor will help you think about your 24 hours a day and how you're best using that to maximize your function. So John mentioned about trigger factors and that they can exacerbate spasticity and spasms. So it's really important that if you get a trigger factor, and they can be things like red skin, even a little blister on your toe can affect a spasm. So it's really important that if you anything like that happens and it's affecting your spasticity or your spasms, then to think about managing that. So, you know, if it's a new pair of shoes that's rubbed a blister, just think about how you'd manage that. But if it's more, maybe you've got a urinary tract infection, that too could trigger your spasms or indeed constipation. So if there's something unusual happening and you're not quite sure why your spasms have started, sometimes ringing your MS nurse or speaking to your MS physio or your community team about why was it started now, you can unpick together what that trigger factor might be, and then a management plan can be instigated.
Choosing the biggest impact can be quite difficult because it might depend on a lot of things, as Lou and John have talked about, but there's a lot that you can do for yourself and there's a lot of physical things that we can do. And if there is some of the tightening and the shortening of the muscles, we might think of different things that can keep them long or gently stretch them or move them to keep them as flexible as possible, because we're trying to counteract the impact of the spasticity. And when we talked about the clonus, if your foot isn't in a good position, if you happen to have a wheelchair, then that's going to impact on that. So there's that real 24-hour approach that Lou was talking about, but it's not just all day for different drugs and things like that. It's actually what you're doing all day as well. And there's lots of positive things that can be done. And it's about doing exercise is not a bad thing, but sometimes some things can cause you to have an increase in spasticity. So it's just getting the balance right. So you might want to discuss that with your physios or your nurses just to make sure that what you're doing is helping. Yeah, again, it's a lot about investigating. It's working out what the issues are, what's actually causing that. And again, sometimes it can be the bladder, the bowel, those different aggravating factors. What we tend to see is that when people stop moving normally, they don't actually move as normally as night either, and you're more still at night. So sometimes if you're more still, you get more pain and more pressure on your body, and they can set off some spasms. So it might be that we would look at your mattress, how you're sleeping, what position you're in, and whether you're comfortable. And sometimes we do recommend things that perhaps people don't really want to think about if you're looking at perhaps changing your bed or your mattress, but that can make a significant difference. And if we can change perhaps some of the things that you use or the cushion that you sit on or the way you sleep, rather than just adding in medication that's always going to have side effects, it's usually a better way to go. It would be a nicer thing to do. So we do use medication, and sometimes there's some very simple medication that can also help that at night. So it's trying to get that balance right between the physical things that we can do to make things more comfortable, to reduce those spasms, and adding in a bit of medication and using that as well. Well, we would always like to try and prevent a contracture, But sometimes these things do happen, and it's trying to make the most of things. So you might find that you're given some exercises that might benefit you, or there may be certain positions that you could be in that help that. Movement is really good. And some people are given resting splints that might help if they're finding it difficult to either move themselves or be moved. So we look at standing regularly, if that's possible with lots of people. There's different pieces of equipment that can do that. Having the right wheelchair, being comfortable. So there's lots of ways of doing things, from very simple stretching exercises through to more complex bits of equipment. And it's the type of thing that we like to look at through the whole of the sort of, want of a better word, journey of people with MS. And I think the earlier we start looking and managing these things, the less likely they're going to turn into things that perhaps become a little bit more troublesome or a bit more uncomfortable.